Welcome to the Cataraqui Woods Dental Implant Institute, a nonprofit organization dedicated to furthering both education and research in the field of oral implantology. My name is Dr. Waji Khan. I'm a dental surgeon and also the course director for an online series of lectures provided as a service to the profession of dentistry to deliver a literature and knowledge-based approach to dental implant education for practitioners interested in learning more about how to implement the discipline of oral implantology into their clinical practice. This online course should be merged with a suitable clinical course and long-term mentorship study club program so that the learner can maximize their benefit from the didactic online program. The production of this series of lectures was partially funded by an educational grant from the International Dental Implant Academy. Lecture 10, Multidisciplinary Cases. So we start getting into a bit of the fun stuff. So multidisciplinary cases, what are they? Well, first of all, they're not for the beginner. Secondly, they can involve all disciplines of dentistry, but commonly involve the disciplines of orthodontics, periodontics, aesthetic dentistry, multi-unit prosthetics or prosthodontics, and endodontics. And the key point here is you need a quarterback. Too many chefs in the kitchen is not a good thing. You need to have somebody who can help coordinate or at least provide some sort of clarity with respect to the final treatment outcome. I realize that we spoke about treatment planning and the old adage, if you fail to plan, you plan to fail. However, this is something which is, you could almost say it's kind of a cliche we tend to put in the back of our minds, we tend to accept, and we tend to easily forget. However, when it comes to things that are like multidisciplinary cases, you need to really ensure that there is some sort of a quarterback or a master planner in order to ensure that the end result is going to be what the patient sought out. So with that in mind, let's start talking about a few cases. So case number one. Case number one is a 20-year-old healthy female who presented to my office, and she had just finished 2 years of orthodontic treatment. And she had a congenitally missing 2-2 and a peg 1-2 lateral incisor. And more or less, she wanted an implant on her 2-2 and on a veneer on her 1-2. And more or less, we'd received a referral letter from her treating orthodontist, basically supporting this requisition and more or less dictating to us that this is the treatment that we were going to do. So when the patient came in to see us, we're going to review this panoral radiograph here, and you can see the peg lateral incisor on the right side, and you can see that there is a congenitally missing upper maxillary left lateral incisor. However, you'll notice that from a cursory review of this panoral radiograph that the maintenance of the space for that lateral incisor was done using some sort of a spring, and more or less what this has done is given a fair amount of mesial tipping to that upper left cuspid, almost making it seem from this a review of this radiograph that there's going to be insufficient space for a implant in this area. And when we take a closer look or a periapical radiograph using some of our treatment planning software that's calibrated, you will note that there's about 3.1 millimeters of space here, which would render it almost impossible to place any sort of an implant solution here without either getting into the periodontal ligament and root of the central incisor or the cuspid. One will also note that the patient had somewhat of a diastema that was left due to the fact that this patient had a very high frenum attachment. So, more or less, treatment plan for this patient, what are we going to do? Well, basically, no patient who just completed 2 years of orthodontics wants to come to your office and receive a treatment option that they may have to have orthodontic treatment again in order to close the diastema between the 1-1 and 2-1, and also to get a distal root tip on the 2-3 in order to facilitate a dental implant solution. The other options for this patient would have been just to go with a traditional bonded resin restoration, or perhaps even prosthodontically trying to address the diastema and also the missing lateral incisor using conventional crown and bridge techniques. However, the patient is 20 years old. So for this patient, she elected for the option of orthodontic treatment to close the diastema between the 1-1, 2-1, and also to get distal root tipping on that 2-3 to facilitate the placement of an implant. We also did a frenectomy for the patient to remove that high frenum attachment. And then the goal was basically to place a regular platform implant in the 2-2 position and restore the implant and restore the 1-2 with a direct resin composite. And then finally, providing the patient with a retainer in the form of a bite plane. So upon reviewing the radiograph, you can see we have the orthodontic appliances in place, and we've basically ensured proper positioning of the orthodontic bracket on the upper left cuspid in order to ensure that there was going to be distal tipping of that root so that we could facilitate placement of an implant. So I believe this picture here is taken a few months into treatment. You can see that the treatment planning software basically shows that there's now 4.1 millimeters of space, and after a period of time, there's 4.7 millimeters. You can see the shadow where the bone is forming and the bone is resorbing in this particular patient. And then finally, once we're good and ready, you can see that we were basically able to create the adequate amount of distal root tip for this patient in this tooth to create 6.1 millimeters of space and what appears to be 16.1 millimeters of height. Also recall that you have to account for the width or the thickness of the bone, so this is a bit misleading. However, there is 6.1 millimeters of space for us now. So at this point in time, we're able to basically proceed with our implant osteotomy, and you'll note that the first guide pin, the pin on the left would dictate that I was a bit perhaps too mesial in terms of my angulation. The angulation was corrected in the guide pin on the right. And finally, an implant was placed at the crestal bone level, and a composite resin with a bracket was added in order to replicate where that tooth would want to be, in order to ensure that the final orthodontic result for this patient was going to be something which would facilitate a adequate prosthetic solution for this patient. Obviously, we're trying to do this in an ideal sort of manner, and from the principles of the golden proportions that we discussed in the treatment planning lectures, you're going to want to ensure that whatever prosthetic that you're trying to create using this temporary composite that I have in this radiograph here is going to be sufficiently the same shape or the same aesthetic that the final result's going to be. And so we'll take a look here at the next picture. It's basically an impression coping, ensuring that that coping is seated. And then the next radiograph or the next radiograph, you can see the final crown, which has been seated for the patient, and that there's good bone levels, and that the crown in itself is going to help retain that position of that cuspid in order to prevent any relapse or any more mesial root tipping of it. And you can see in a photograph here the direct resin composite and the implant with a gorgeous emergence profile in place. This patient was happy. Case number two. So case number two is a 46-year-old healthy female who presented to our office, and more or less her chief complaint was she was seeking to have an ideal smile. She wanted the best that we could do for her. Cost was not an issue. And she didn't really like her existing teeth. The main concern she had was she had some congenitally missing cuspids, and she wasn't very happy with the large resin buildups that were on her anterior teeth. You know, it's easy to sort of knock other people's work and stuff. However, what you're going to see in the next photograph was dentistry that was, you know, 10, 20 years old. So for 10 to 20-year-old technology or 10 to 20-year-old material, whoever had done this work for her had done a pretty good job considering whatever budget limitations or material limitations they had at the time. She also noted to us that she did not want a bridge, and this is the photograph we're going to take a look at here, or sorry, the radiograph first. So taking a look at the panoral radiograph, one can see that she does have some existing Maryland bridges that are in place. There appears to be some heavy restoration of those maxillary incisors, and there appears to be a sufficient amount of bone height, not necessarily width here, but bone height for a dental implant solution. The root form is adequate, and we're going to note also that there's not really a lot of bone loss or periodontal disease or other restorative issues for this patient. So more or less, the photograph that corresponds with this, you'll see here, as I'd mentioned, you can't really knock what's there. It looks pretty good. I'm sure 20 years ago when this was first placed, this looked a lot better. But, you know, there's in 2015, or when we did this case, 2012, there's a lot better that we can do for this patient. So taking a look also at the patient's maxillary and mandibular arches, you can see there's a fair amount of crowding there. Shouldn't say a fair amount of crowding. There's some minor crowding there in the mandibular anterior. Many patients present to the orthodontist with predominantly a chief complaint that they want their mandibular incisors straightened. So in this particular patient's case, she wanted to have her mandibular incisors straightened. There was the option of straightening these prosthetically using veneers or very aggressive veneers. However, when we're considering an orthodontic solution for this patient, considering the fact that any sort of restoration is going to have to last 15 to 20 years, and this patient's in her mid-40s, there's no reason to basically to commit this patient to having to replace these restorations in 15 to 20 years time, when we can easily deal with her chief complaint about wanting to have an ideal smile orthodontically. So the treatment plan for this patient basically is orthodontic treatment to idealize the arch forms, maintain adequate overbite overjet, and also to ensure that the root forms of the teeth don't impact upon our ability to put implants in for this patient. We're going to look at getting a diagnostic wax up in this case here before we even start. So the main reason for this is it's easier to invest a couple hundred bucks in a diagnostic wax up and provide the patient with sort of an idea of what your things are going to look like at the end, as opposed to getting through a couple $1,000 worth of treatment, inserting a bunch of restorations inside your patient, only to have your patient say that this is not what their concept or their idea of what things were going to look like at the end are. And then finally, implant placement and healing for this patient. Whitening, this patient wanted really, really white teeth. And the plan for this patient basically was 4 crowns in the maxillary anterior, 2 implant crowns for the maxillary cuspids, and then 4 veneers in order to address some of the issues with color, shape, and form of her premolars, and also to sort of help get the ideal sort of buccal window appearance that this patient is looking for. Because when she smiles, she shows a lot of teeth. And then finally, lastly, retainers for the patient and a bite plane, as we're going to discuss later in this lecture. Pretty much every patient who I do either very expensive prosthetic work or implants on, they get a bite plate. Actually, come to think of it, my mentor in dentistry, she basically, even if she did a porcelain crown, just a single crown for a patient, she provided them with a bite plate. And her basic rationale was, if you're spending money on making teeth look good, there's no point in having the one in a thousand patient who you didn't suspect was going to be a bruxer, brux something and cause problems for you. So putting a bite plate in a patient is always a good thing. So looking at the radiographs here, you can see that the orthodontic appliances are in place. And this is basically midway through ortho. You can see that we're basically ready to place the implants in for this patient. So in the next set of radiographs here, you can see that we have the guide pins in place, basically indicating to us that we're going in the proper vertical direction and not hitting the roots, adjacent roots. And in this particular case, this is kind of one of those, not going to say slam dunk cases. You can always find, whenever you think a case is too easy, that's when things are going to go wrong. But there's lots and lots and lots of room in this particular case. However, the angulation of implants, as we're going to discuss, we have discussed in lecture 9, the prosthetic phase, one of the things that's very important is to make sure you get the angulation right, because it does impact upon the emergence profile provided for the patient. And obviously the patient in this particular case, she wants an ideal smile. And part of that ideal smile is an ideal gingival zenith or an ideal emergence profile. So if we can help prevent problems at this stage, why not? So taking a look at the next set of radiographs, you can see that the implants are in place with the cover screws. And I believe in the next shot here, we get the composites. So similar to the previous case, you want to ensure that the composites with the brackets on them are going to sort of simulate the aesthetic or the final aesthetic for in terms of shape for the teeth that the patient's going to receive. There's no point in basically handcuffing your laboratory and having them give a patient eye teeth or premolars or even lateral incisors that are going to have to accommodate for the fact that when you had so much control from an orthodontic perspective in terms of opening or closing this space, that you basically handcuffed them in terms of the size of prosthesis that the patient was going to get. Going back to that golden proportions lecture from lecture in the treatment plan lecture. So in this picture here, you can see that we have our maxillary crowns cemented, and you can see that we have the implants that have been restored as well. And you can see from the premolar teeth that those teeth have not had their respective restoration cemented at this point in time. And in the next photograph, you can see basically a set of bite wing radiographs for orthodontic treatment for this particular patient. And In the next photograph, you can see the final case cemented. And when you have this much work that you're going to do for a patient and this much control, there's really a low likelihood, if you planned everything properly, that this is not going to look good. And she was ecstatic with the result. And you can see an occlusal shot here. You can see the orifices that have been closed for those screw-retained crowns and the veneers and the crowns that have been cemented for this patient. And finally, just a full frontal smile view. You can see that this patient was very, very happy. So a before and after, this is where we started, and this is where we were able to end in this particular case. Happy endings are always good. And as we said before, surprises in implant dentistry are never a good thing. So case number three, what do we have? We have a 42-year-old female who works in the service industry, and she has a very heavy, heavy bruxism habit. Normally when you see teeth like this, it's usually men. In this particular case, this lady has a very heavy bruxism habit. It's almost like a class 3 endon occlusion, and you can see that she's lost a number of her teeth or posterior teeth, and in many cases people start using the maxillary incisors and mandibular incisors inappropriately to chew, remembering from dental school 101 that the incisors are basically there to incise and the molars and the premolars are there to chew. You do about 90% of your chewing in that second premolar, first molar region. So in this particular patient's case, for circumstances outside of her control, she wasn't able to access dental care and she was missing a lot of teeth. And from her perspective, she basically wanted things to look a lot better. And she wanted to restore her self-confidence and her aesthetic ability to smile. So what are we going to do for her? So we'll take a look at the corresponding intraoral shot here. You can see that these teeth are fairly worn. That's with her open a little bit. And here's a radiograph basically demonstrating the remaining teeth, the bone levels, and just some of the other salient points in this particular case. So from this patient's perspective, this is obviously not an easy treatment plan. In this case, records are going to be very important, and in the form of making sure that you have appropriate pre-treatment records. So when you're trying to treatment plan, you have everything that's available, to not just to yourself, but to any of the other colleagues you're going to be working with on this particular case, and also your laboratory. Many times people discount the fact that labs can definitely benefit from photographs, radiographs, and other records that you can provide to them. It's not just those those stone models that they receive and you expect them to sort of come up with some sort of miracle. It's not like a game of Where's Waldo, where you just basically send a certain model to a lab and a lab's supposed to figure out what to do. So in this particular case, what we wanted for this patient were tons of records. And after getting those records, we asked the lab for a diagnostic wax-up. And the purpose of the diagnostic wax-up is basically to form an orthotic to see if we can increase the vertical dimension for this patient. This patient has a fairly worn dentition. We're going to assume that she's overclosed. And in order to provide any form of reasonable prosthetic intervention in this particular patient's case, we're going to need some sort of an orthotic to see if the patient can tolerate the vertical dimension. And when you say tolerate the vertical dimension, there's two reasons why you want to increase the vertical dimension. Number one is to break the engram patterns that the particular patient has from a bruxism perspective. Number two, you also want to ensure that the patient is going to, from a stigmatnathory, I'll use a big word there, perspective, that they can, their temporomandibular joint, their muscles, their joints, their ligaments can tolerate this increased vertical dimension. So the nice thing about an orthotic is that with a proper impression, you're going to take a polyvinyl siloxane impression and send that to your lab with mounted models on an articulator and ask them to open anywhere from 2 to 4 millimeters at the pin. And basically the purpose of this orthotic is to basically have them wear it 24 hours a day when they eat, sleep, a whole shebang, and see if they're able to tolerate this increased vertical dimension. And the minimum amount of time you want to do this is for around 6 months. And if it's the case that they can do this, we can continue along with our treatment plan. So we did the basic restorative and hygiene for this patient and then follow along with placing some implants and providing some time for some healing. And the goal for this patient is going to be basically crowns, a couple of implants, and 4 veneers. And then lastly, we're going to need a bite plane for this patient. So in the next photograph here, you can sort of just sort of see a picture. Forgive the fracture line there. This is just, I don't have the orthotic picture here, but the patient was able to tolerate the orthotic, and this was going to be the diagnostic wax-up demonstrating to the patient what the final result was going to look like. And for this particular patient, she was happy with this. You can see the excess bisacryl material that has been provided in the back there. And this was the final result that we were able to achieve for this patient. Now, this is without the implants restored in the maxillary premolar region, but you'll notice that we sort of goofed up a little bit here in the sense that her gingival zenith, so if you just take a look at the right side looks awesome. The left side's like, doesn't really look that good. So we were able to bone sound her and more or less do a little bit of a minor gingivectomy there on the upper right central and lateral incisors, and then finally provide her with a nicer aesthetic result. So you'll see in the photograph that sort of comes next, this was the final result. And you know, from her perspective, she was very happy. She was very happy. Now, am I happy? Not necessarily happy with the plane of occlusion. I kind of had my hands cuffed with respect to the existing mandibular teeth. However, you can't always dictate your aesthetic goals upon the patient. So she was very happy with this. My goals were not necessarily achieved, but the most important thing was that she was happy with the result from aesthetic perspective, and that from my perspective, she was wearing her bite plate. So it goes into the next topic about bruxism, and a few of my colleagues refer to bruxism as the grim reaper of dentistry. Now, in this particular patient's case, I mentioned all of the things that we addressed. You'll notice this photograph here, a tornado, right? Bruxism is like a tornado in dentistry. It will basically destroy all of the good work that you worked really hard to do. So in this particular patient's case, yes, you could argue that she was inappropriately using those incisors to chew, and that's why the teeth broke down. I would argue no. There is probably a large bruxism component in here. And as I mentioned already with the comment of my mentor, who basically, if she provided a patient with any form of porcelain prosthetic, she provided them with a bite plane. And there's another saying in the world, is they say, don't shoot yourself in the foot. And if you're going to shoot yourself in the foot, don't reload the gun. So this famous guy here, I don't always get hit by green shells, but when I do, they're my own. So don't shoot yourself in the foot. If it's the case you're doing a large case like this, make sure you give people a bite plane. So in this next slide, you say, don't reload the gun. The mandible basically always wants to move to the anterior. And by giving the patient a bite plane and ensuring that they're wearing it, you're going to ensure that all of this beautiful work that you've done for patients isn't going to end up as sort of like the armpit joke of some other colleague 10 or 15 years down the road. So principles of large cases. Basically, you need a wax up. You need some form of provisionalization. Provisionalization basically allows you to try everything out, and then basically when you're doing the final restoration, copy your homework. It's like having the exam a week before having to write it, and then you have to basically go write the exam. It makes your life a lot easier. Why learn in the permanent stage or have to go back like I did in my case and basically go back and redo a bunch of restorations when we should have learned this from the provisionalization stage? It also gives you an opportunity to reorganize the occlusion for the patient, to create some anterior guidance, to eliminate posterior contacts and excursions, as these are not going to be good for implants. And then you want 24/7 wear of the orthotic. And it has to be a phonetically acceptable orthotic for the patient. So there's no point in having patients walk around and not be able to talk and have the final result be like that as well. That's going to be unacceptable. You can also do other things with larger case principles in terms of increasing the implant size or increasing the number of implants. So spreading the forces across a number of implants and splinting things as opposed to just having them go across one implant. There's also has been a vast improvement in prosthetic design and materials over the years. So we're just going to talk a little bit about the anatomical splint. Basically, the nice thing about the anatomical splint, as we described in this case, is it's a reversible change. It's easy to adjust. It's easier to accept for speech, unlike a bite plane for a patient. It's relatively inexpensive, and it provides you with great diagnostic information. And one of my colleagues basically says it allows for a test drive. So it allows you to basically test drive what you're presenting for the patient. It allows you to write an exam or see an exam prior to having to write it. It allows you to basically copy your homework, and it gives you some great information. And the last thing it does is it eliminates muscle memory and engram patterns. So some people would argue that when you actually restore patients or open up their occlusions, that you actually will reduce their ability or reduce their tendency to want to brux their teeth. So moving along, in order to make an anatomical splint, how are you going to do this? So basically what you want to do is to fan gauge to open them in the anterior, and then you take a bite registration with this fan gauge in a relaxed bite position, and you send this off to your lab, and your lab can manufacture this orthotic for you. So case number four, what are we going to talk about here? So this is an 85-year-old healthy male who's retired, and he wants to eat steak. What I didn't know about this 85-year-old gentleman was that he actually is one of the most active 85-year-old gentlemen ever. This particular gentleman was actually the provincial coach for a particular sport, and after we completed his treatment, he invited myself and a colleague of mine out for this particular sport. At the time, I was in my mid-30s. I thought I'd take it easy on this guy, and he ended up basically putting myself and my 20-year-old colleague under the table, as we'd say. So if we're going to talk about multidisciplinary cases, sometimes your patients are in better shape than you. So just because they're 85, don't judge them. So take a look at this gentleman's particular case. He was committed to wearing a complete upper denture, and his lower teeth were basically heavily restored and starting to break down. This gentleman was a veteran and had a lot of his work done while he was in the service, and in his particular case, he was ready to basically get a much nicer aesthetic and functional result, but he didn't want to have a traditional denture. So this is a photograph of his residual ridge, and as you can see, just visually, it appears as though there's very thick bone. If you were to bone sound this patient or take a cone beam CT, if you want to do that, you'll find that there's a ton of bone in this patient's particular case. So the treatment plan for this gentleman was bone sounding to ensure there's going to be adequate bone for an implant solution. A wax up of a denture to see if there's room for a particular mesostructure. So when you're doing things like a bar, retained complete upper denture, you need at least 17 millimeters of clearance in order to ensure that there's going to be sufficient room for the implants, for the bar, for the locator attachments or hater clips or MK1 attachments or any of that sort of stuff. And also a sufficient acrylic or metal to ensure that the final prosthesis that's going to be going on here isn't going to break every week through the actions of occlusion. And then basically for this patient, it was going to be 6 implants in the maxilla for the provision of a CAD-CAM titanium bar with locators, and then 4 implants in the anterior mandible with locators for the purposes of having a removable complete upper denture with an open palate and also a removable complete lower denture. So in this next picture here, you can see that we have basically taken a surgical skin marker. So these surgical skin markers are commonly available, and they're nice to use. The nice thing about a surgical skin marker is that, first of all, they're not toxic, and number two, it sort of helps sort of guide out where you're going to place everything. So in this particular case, we use these Genetian Violet surgical skin marker to sort of adequately space out and mark out where we're going to place the implants for this patient. And in the next picture, you can sort of see the guide pins that have been put in place for this patient. And after these guide pins have been put in place, we place the number of 3.75 millimeter regular platform, 11.5 millimeter long implants for this patient. These particular implants were MIS implants, MIS 7s. And you can see in the next photograph just the pins, the implants sticking out, and here's a clinical picture of the implants inside the patient. So you can see we did this using a flapless technique, and with the cover screws then that go on top, here's a picture of those. You can see that we put those on. In this case, actually, you can see these healing collars that we placed on this particular patient. And finally, after the healing collars go in, a few months go by, you bring the patient back. This patient had excellent oral hygiene around these healing collars and underneath his denture. We talk about this in the management of complications or the maintenance of dental implants lecture. So you'll see that the tissue around this implant, these implants looks unbelievable. So taking a there's a radiograph now with some impression copings that have been put into place, locked together with composite resin in order to ensure that there's going to be no movement with this impression. This is sent off to the laboratory, and this, you can see this picture here, a picture of this open tray impression for this patient. And the underside of this impression basically shows that we've taken an adequate impression with adequate extensions. Remember that these impressions are going to be used in order to wax up the dentures that are going to be used to fabricate a bar. So this impression has to be just as good as any other impression that you'd normally take for a denture, because the denture will be processed on the bar on this model. So in this particular patient's case, you can see that we've attached some implant analogs onto the impression copings. And finally, after that, you can manufacture or fabricate a model with a soft tissue replica to facilitate creation of the CAD/CAM titanium bar, and also to have the wax up for the denture created. So this is the bar that we get back, the bar with the locators, and this is back from the lab. You can see that evaluated. Once again, we bring the patient back, and here's another view of the tissue for this patient after removing those healing collars. And once again, you can see that this is ideal oral hygiene on behalf of the patient. So patients tell you here, you know, what type of patient they're going to be. Normally, I don't like doing fixed prosthesis for patients, namely because most of the time patients, they're not going to clean around them. And it's an absolute horror trying to bring these people in once or twice a year and remove these fixed prostheses for them. However, in this particular patient's case, with oral hygiene like this, going with time, these people come back to you, you get to decide or declare themselves, is this going to be a patient I want to do a fixed prosthesis for, or is this a patient that we're going to do a removable prosthesis for? So we're still doing a removable prosthesis for this patient. However, had this gentleman said to me, you know, I want something fixed, I actually would have considered giving him one. So looking at the next photograph here, you can see that the try-in of the bar in place, and this is without the locator attachments in. And in the next picture, you can see the locator attachments onto the bar. And here is a radiograph demonstrating the bar seated with the locator attachments. And in the mandible, you can see the mandibular implants that are in place. In the next picture, you can see the clinical appearance of the tissue in the mandible where these locators are going to go. And in the next photograph, you can see that we've actually placed the locator attachments for this patient. And the next photograph basically shows the final result, which is the a picture and smile for this patient of the upper denture and lower dentures in place. And here's a occlusal shot showing the open palate for this particular patient, and a retracted shot showing the dentures for this patient. So case number 5, what do we have here? This is a 62-year-old healthy male who basically is seeking an implant for the maxillary right central incisor. He's tired of wearing his flipper. He wants something that's going to look good. So taking a look at the photograph of this patient, you're going to see that he's missing his upper right central incisor, but he's been missing this tooth for a long time. And it doesn't take a genius to basically notice that there's a bit of a midline shift here, that if we were to just place an implant in the central incisor position and restore it, that the central incisor would probably end up being smaller than that lateral incisor, and that the other central incisor sort of is impinging upon the space, and there's also a bit of a midline gap. So, I mean, the slam dunk answer sort of here would be, or at least certainly say slam dunk, after doing a thorough treatment planning for this patient, you can determine that there's something that we can do for him that's going to make things look nice. So here's a retracted shot here, basically demonstrating the same things we just talked about, and an occlusal shot demonstrating a bit of a buccal bone deficiency. So what are we going to do for this patient? Here's a panoral radiograph just demonstrating that this patient has a couple of other dental treatment needs that need to be addressed as well. So after addressing those other treatment needs, we take a periapical radiograph. You'll notice that there is a reduction in the bone height for this patient as well. There is adequate root form, but however, the spacing, there's about 8.8 millimeters size of that left maxillary central incisor, and about 7.1 millimeters of space for the right central incisor. You'll know from your treatment planning for aesthetic dentistry lecture that the standard central incisor is about 8.5 millimeters or 8 millimeters wide and 10 millimeters long. So if we were to take the 0.8 from the other side and add it over to the left side, you'll notice that we should be able to get some sort of parity for this patient with respect to the relative proportions of those teeth. So the treatment plan for this patient is obviously consent. Number two, we want a diagnostic wax up to make sure that the final result that we're going to provide this patient is going to be exactly what we described. Number two, three, we're going to do a place an implant in the 1-1 area, the right maxillary central incisor, using some sticky bone graft and platelet-rich fibrin in order to augment some of that buccal bone deficiency for the patient. And we're going to give them an all ceramic crown on the left maxillary central incisor or tooth number 2-1, and then finally insert it, and then, as you guessed it, a bite plate for the patient at the end and follow up. So here's a photograph of us with a full thickness flap to place that implant, and you'll notice that we have a nice C shape on the implant. However, there is some fenestration or dehiscence of the bone in the coronal aspect, and in this bone, basically, we're going to place some bone graft with some sticky bone and PRF and some platelet-rich fibrin membrane, and then suture that down. On the next picture, you can see that that's been done. And then the patient goes away. Here's a post-op radiograph basically demonstrating the graft and the implant in place. And then the patient returns after some time, and you'll notice that when we're going back after this implant, you'll see that there is increase in the width of the bone in that right maxillary central incisor position, and that's from us using that sticky bone graft. You'll have to read up on Dr. Joseph Chacroon's technique for sticky bone. It is an amazing way to get rigidity of a particulate bone graft in a patient without subjecting a patient to the morbidity of a cortical onlay bone graft. So in this next picture you see here, the tissue punch incision that we used. So when you're grafting bone and you've received a nice result, don't go back and flap it and reduce the periosteal blood supply to it. That would be bad, bad, bad. So in this particular case, we used the tissue punch, and you also see the crown prep that we did on the left maxillary central incisor, ensuring that we use some sort of a putty or other form of stent to ensure that the reduction that we've done from the mesial aspect, because remember that we're going to be taking 0.8 millimeters away. So you actually want to take 0.8 millimeters away from that left maxillary central incisor and then accommodate for your standard crown preparation. So I'm not trying to say be aggressive with your crown prep, but more or less you need to provide your technician with that room so that the final result's going to look good. And in this picture, you can see that we're taking our impression for our crown and our implant using an open tray technique at the same time. And in the next picture, you can see a periapical radiograph of the impression coping in place along with the margins of that crown prep. And in this picture, you can see that we were able to take the impression for the tooth and the impression of the implant both at the same time. So we put this little implant analog on and we send this off to our lab. And the lab, of course, you know, they want nice margins on that impression. A colleague of mine, or actually a master dental lab tech, once told me, when you're taking an impression, you're not taking an impression of the margin. You actually want a millimeter beyond the margin to help the technician have an idea of what the emergence profile of this tooth is going to look like, and to give you a nice porcelain margin that's going to, you know, smoothly go across the root surface and not be that clunk that sometimes we get with porcelain margins. So looking at the lab model, you can see that there is a soft tissue pore up here, and along with the crown prep that we can see. And intraorally, this is the healing abutment and the temporary crown that we've provided. And as you can see in the next photograph, the temporary crown was not necessarily the most aesthetic, but it served its purpose. Fortunately for me, I was able to get the crown back for this patient in about 2 days. And finally, the clinical shot, removing the temporary, removing the healing abutment. You can see that the oral hygiene around that healing abutment was excellent, as was the oral hygiene around the temporary crown. And here's a photograph from an occlusal perspective of the crown cemented along with the screw retained implant crown that has been inserted for this patient. And we're going to basically go next to clinical shot showing you what this looks like, and you can see that the crown has been cemented. There's a little bit of irritation of the gingival margin there on the buccal aspect, and you can see some whitening of the tissue around where the implant crown went. And the nice thing about this whiteness is you're basically going to push up against that tissue, and it's going to pink up after about 10 or 15 minutes. But what it really allows to get a nice emergence profile on that implant crown, because you want it to look like a natural tooth. You don't want it to look like it's a fake tooth sticking onto an implant. And here's a shot of the patient. And I'm going to note here, we didn't do any whitening for this patient. We didn't do any incisal recontouring. We didn't modify anything else. This is basically just working on the two central incisors. So going back to those principles of cosmetic dentistry, dominance of the central incisors, you see that this looks really good. Here's a radiograph basically demonstrating what the bone levels look like around the implant, showing you some of the emergence profile around the soft and hard tissues, or I shouldn't say soft tissues, a radiograph, what am I saying? The radiograph demonstrating the hard tissue profile around the implant in the teeth. You can also see the margins of the crowns on that left central incisor. And then you can just sort of see here in this photograph here, a picture of before and after. And like I said, we basically just worked on those, on the central incisors. We didn't do anything else. And more or less, we were able to, using proper treatment planning, correct the midline, get better axial inclination, get that dominance of the central incisors. And this patient was very, very, very happy. Case number 6, we have a 72-year-old healthy female who basically presents seeking replacement of missing teeth for improved masticatory efficiency. So we'll review her panoral radiograph, and you can see that this lovely lady is more or less missing molars on the bottom right and bottom left, and molars in the maxillary left and maxillary left and mandibular left. So more or less, this lady said, you know, she wants some more teeth and she wants some implants. And so after going through the standard treatment planning process for this patient, we come up with a treatment plan of consent, number 2, 2 implants in the posterior right mandible, 1 implant in the posterior left maxilla, and then insert some crowns initially for this patient in order to get her started. And then finally, a bite plane. So moving along here, you'll see the radiograph of the 2 narrow platform implants placed in the mandibular right. We went with narrow platform implants for this patient because she was 72. She didn't want to be subjected to the morbidity of any sort of ridge splitting or ridge widening procedure. I said, okay, we could put 2 narrow platform implants in at a sufficient length with sufficient width of bone volume around them and just splint them together. And that should be able to provide us with an adequate solution. So here's a photograph or a radiograph, of the impression copings locked in place. Here's a clinical picture of what these implants look like in the model. Going to the next shot, you'll see the clinical picture of the implants inside the mouth. Once again, great soft tissue response around this. Patient's got excellent oral hygiene. You can sort of gauge from the appearance of the premolar there. This patient has a bit of a parafunctional habit. Here's a, once again, another picture with a mirror demonstrating the soft tissue around these implants. Here's the model demonstrating the amount of space and the soft tissue pore up inside this model. And clinically, you can see those 2 splinted crowns in place. She did have about 1.8 millimeters of crestal bone loss on that anterior implant. However, this has been stable throughout time. And basically, this is a photograph of the tooth that has been removed in the maxillary left and the immediate implant that has been placed. And we did the exact same thing. We placed in this case, it wasn't platelet-rich fiber. It was a collar plug and sutured in with a figure 8 suture in order to help retain that. In the next radiograph, we can demonstrate what this implant looked like the day we placed it, and here's a photograph or radiograph of that implant restored, clinically what it looks like. And all of a sudden, you're probably wondering, okay, what's the multidisciplinary aspect of this? Okay, mid-treatment plan changes. Okay, surprise. Surprises are never good in implant dentistry. So she basically came back somewhere in the middle of treatment and said, I've broken a tooth, and oh boy, let's take a look here. Oh boy, on the top right, second premolar, looks like there's caries or something going on with this tooth, and there's a fairly hypercementotic or bulbous root on this tooth. And she says to me, I want another implant. And I said, okay, well, okay, what are we supposed to do here? So, all right, so we have a picture here of what this looks like. And more or less, we end up taking this tooth out for her, placing an implant in for her, once again, taking a bit of a collar plug and suturing that inside there for this particular patient. And I said, okay, everything's going to be fine and dandy. Everything's great. And then she comes back to see me about a month later. This is after the placement of the implant, and starts complaining of pain in the area. And I took a radiograph, and in this radiograph, you can see radiographically, there's no issues. Clinically, it didn't appear there'd be any issues. I said, okay, you know, maybe just be the case that, you know, we took a tooth away and, you know, some of the other teeth are upset. You know, maybe you're bruxing your teeth. Maybe you bruised your tooth. Okay, something conservative, okay? We took a panoral radiograph. You can see in the panoral radiograph, there's really nothing that you can sort of comment on. And she came back once again, complaining of discomfort. And she's now pointing towards the 1-4, or the premolar. And so we took a look at the premolar. We probed around it. We checked it in occlusion. We checked. We reduced the occlusion for her. We took a periapical radiograph. Once again, no real issues around it. And then I believe like a week or two later, she presents with what appears to be a fistula on the buccal aspect of the 1-4. And my concern was that this fistula was related to the implant and not to the actual, not to one of the other teeth. And lo and behold, after tracking this fistula with a piece of gutta percha, you'll notice that this patient basically required endodontic retreatment of the premolar tooth. It took a little bit of while, time for this to clinically declare itself and for us to diagnose this for the patient. But once we were able to do so, more or less, endodontic retreatment of that premolar, number one cause of endodontic failure, that being coronal leakage. In this particular patient's case, she had a restoration on this tooth. She originally had a crown on it, and it was done after. And so she had a restoration that was leaking. So we were able to, we had to address this leaking restoration as well after endodontic retreatment. And you'll see with the healing abutment on there on the upper right second premolar. We take have an impression coping there that's nicely seated, and we will restore this case. So the multidisciplinary aspect of this case was that sometimes when you're placing an implant, patients will have complications. You know, life does happen, but don't always think that post-op complications are necessarily going to be due just to your implant. It could be due to a variety of other things as well. Other problems can occur. And in this particular case, what occurred was a lesion of endodontic origin. So here's a photograph basically demonstrating the restored implant and the screw access hole, or sorry, the access hole for the endodontic retreatment and the sealed restoration that we put on. And you can see that the tissue looks nice and healthy now. And case number 7. So case number 7, what do we have? We have a 32-year-old male who's basically seeking to have an ideal smile. He doesn't like his existing teeth at all. And more or less, from his perspective, you can see in this panoral radiograph that this gentleman more or less has some mandibular crowding. He has some maxillary cuspids that are impacted. As a result of this, he has a bit of a shifted dentition. So he wants an ideal smile. So what's he willing to do? So more or less, first of all, consent for this patient, orthodontic treatment, vital bleaching. Number 4, surgical exposure or extraction of those impacted cuspids and implant placement for the maxillary canines. Now, one thing I can tell you about surgical exposure bringing those teeth down from an orthodontic perspective, it's not necessarily always easy. Many times, especially when patients are older, it can lead to significant bony voids or bony defects, not to mention the morbidity that's associated with actually accessing these teeth and bringing them down. Extraction is also an option. However, once again, the morbidity that's associated with taking these teeth out. And lastly, inserting crowns for this patient and a bite plan and retainers, and then follow-up. So you'll see here that we started orthodontic treatment for this patient and basically started getting his arches aligned fairly nicely and more or less prepping us or getting us ready for the provision of some implants for this patient. So once we were good and ready, you can see that everything looks a lot better in this radiograph here. We used our implant treatment planning software and determined, okay, there's going to be adequate width of adequate height to place some implants in the eye teeth for this patient. He wanted implants. He didn't want a Maryland bridge or a bridge or something on those lines. He wanted implants if we could do it. So I said, okay, let's take a look here. All we got to do is figure out how we're going to get these eye teeth out now. So the next photograph, moving along. And then in the next radiograph, you can see that we've placed an implant in the mandibular left, and we're able to put a healing abutment on there. Now, the space that we were able to generate for this missing molar wasn't that great, so basically it's like a third premolar, but he was happy with the outcome that we were able to provide for him. And we sent him for a cone beam CT in order to determine the exact position of these eye teeth so that we can figure out how we could take them out. And you can see from this cone beam CT that more or less it's demonstrating that these teeth are not buccal, they're not palatal, but they're sort of right in the middle of the bone. And more or less, this was going to be significant morbidity with respect to going after these teeth. And more or less, my oral radiologist had told me that there was going to be insufficient ability to give this patient an implant solution with the eye teeth in place. And the patient wasn't willing to go through the morbidity that's going to be associated with getting these teeth out. And so I had to have a difficult conversation with this patient and basically tell him the only option or the only realistic option that we have for you is to consider giving you either a Maryland bridge or give you a conventional bridge. And he wasn't really keen on either of those options, but after having gone through almost a 3-year treatment plan, he said, okay, you know what, let's just go with the Maryland bridge. So as everything goes in life, sometimes you're just in one place, in one particular place, in one particular time. I just happened to be at the Faculty of Dentistry at the University of Toronto at the time. So you're looking at this photograph here, you can see this patient, basically the case is all done. The teeth are aligned. Everything's done but getting these cuspids restored for this patient. And you can see from the arch form perspective, here's a picture of the maxillary arch form. And you can see the only thing missing are those eye teeth. And here's the mandibular arch form. He's very happy with the way things are looking. So as I mentioned to you, I was at the University of Toronto and a colleague of mine basically presented this picture to me. He said, hey, check this out. I said, holy Jesus, that's kind of neat. Those implants are buccal or palatal too. And my colleague said to me, nope, these implants are going right through the tooth. I said, right through the tooth? I said, can you do that? And she said, yeah. I said, okay, well, that's kind of interesting that you can do that. So I said, hey, let's do a literature review on this. Paradigm shifts. Paradigm shifts are something that we always come to us in dentistry. People always say, you can't do that. Well, can we do that or can we not do that? Or do we do something because we're told so? One of my colleagues one time, he said to me, why do you do that particular technique or why do you use that technique? And I said, because some old man told me to do it that way in dental school, and that's why we do it. We don't really challenge some of our dogmatic views in our profession. And if you were to say, go out there and actually ask yourself how much literature review or how much strong evidence there is for many of the things that we do. In Canada, I can tell you that the only sort of like clinical practice guidelines that really ever came out, one was for acute periapical abscess, the other one was for an acute periapical periodontitis. And these are the only two that were really generated over time. I haven't really seen any others. So there's a paper that came out, unconventional implant placement to placement of implants through impacted teeth, 3 case reports. And this was reported in the literature in the International Journal of Periodontics Restorative Dentistry in 2009. There's also an interesting paper presented in 2013 in the Oral Journal of Oral Maxillofacial Surgery, which was called, referred to as Dental Integration of a Titanium Implant, a case report. So more or less, they were talking about cells inside the pulp that were basically able to, in some way, shape, or form, integrate with a titanium implant. So not to say that a few papers are the way to go, but I discussed this possibility with my patient. So in this radiograph here, you can see that we more or less have spaced things out, said, okay, you can even see that those premolars actually already have Maryland bridge preps done on them. We actually tried the Maryland bridges for this patient, and he absolutely hated them. And so I discussed these case reports with my patient. I went over the risks that would be associated with proceeding with a treatment plan in which we more or less were going to put implants right through his teeth or close to them. And more or less, he was willing to accept the risks. I told him, if things go bad, we're going to have to basically get those teeth out. And he said, the way things look with these Maryland bridges, I'd rather run that risk. So being ethical about it, is, okay, let's try one side at a time. So more or less, you can see in this picture here, this occlusal shot, you can actually see the preparation of that Maryland bridge, that half chamfer on that premolar. And more or less, what we did was place an implant. And well, if you're going to try this, I wouldn't suggest you use a brand new set of burrs. Use some disposable burrs, because when you're drilling through a tooth, it's just like drilling through any other tooth. It's not easy. Using a guide pin to ensure that we're going in the proper direction. And in the next picture, you can actually see the implants that have been placed on the left and the right. And in both cases, we are compromising the tooth structure. This was given around 3 months to heal. And once this had all settled down, we brought the patient back for follow-up. No reported symptoms. I kept a close eye on this case. We actually gave this patient the full amount of time that was going to be required for osseointegration, or dentointegration, as we'd say it. So we gave him the full 6 months. And at that point in time, we basically brought the patient back. We were able to take fixture level impressions using an open tray technique for this patient. And these are some radiographs of this case restored. And in the next photograph, you'll actually see a picture of what the tissue looks like on the right and the restored implant on the left. And in the next picture, you'll see an occlusal shot of both of the implants that have been restored. Once again, we still haven't addressed those preparations that we've done for the Maryland bridges for this patient. I'm sure restoring that's going to be the least of his concerns. But when you see the front end view of this case restored and the emergence profile and the aesthetic, I can tell you that this patient was just absolutely ecstatic about the end result. So in summary, multidisciplinary cases, these are not for the beginner. They can involve all disciplines of dentistry, but commonly involve orthodontic, periodontic, aesthetic, multi-unit prosthetics, and endodontics. You need a quarterback. You absolutely need a quarterback. Too many chefs in the kitchen is not a good thing. So to go from something like this, right, a patient who comes in who's seeking a implant solution, and be able to give them something that looks, you know, good like this, you know, takes timing, it takes coordination, takes dedication, and more or less it takes an appropriate amount of understanding, not only on your part but on the part of your patient, with respect to what's going to be taking place. Sometimes people want a magic bullet solution. There was a colleague of mine who once told me that everyone wants something for nothing. You need to make sure that patients are well aware of the time commitment, not just in terms of like physical time, but also in terms of the monetary commitment and the time commitment that's going to come to taking care of these prostheses that we give patients. A colleague of mine basically likes to describe implant retained dentures as the Ferrari of dentures. And what he means by that, more or less, is it doesn't cost as much as a Ferrari, or at least it shouldn't cost as much as a Ferrari unless you're practicing in Dubai or something. But more or less, I was always amazed that after spending $200,000-$300,000 on a car, after driving it for 10,000 kilometers, that it's going to require $15,000 of maintenance. I always used to be of the opinion saying, well, if I spend $300,000 on a car, I expect that thing to drive forever. And believe it or not, as silly as that sounds, that's the attitude of many of our patients. After spending $20,000, $30,000, $40,000 on an implant retained dental solution, they believe that there's no maintenance required, or that these things are going to last forever. And that's not the way it's supposed to be. So it's very important to ensure that before you get into big cases like this, that you talk to your patients and ensure they're on board, and that they understand that there's going to be not just a financial commitment from them from a long-term perspective, but also a commitment in terms of taking care of these prostheses, coming in regularly, cleaning it at home, and ensuring that they don't run into problems with their implant prosthetics. So the next lecture we have for you is lecture 11, which is about long-term follow-up and maintenance of these types of cases. And as previously, in previous lectures, we provided all the references that we've used in the production of this lecture series. So on behalf of the entire dental treatment team at the Cataraqui Woods Dental Implant Institute, I want to thank you for listening to our lecture.